Distinguished future physicians, welcome to Stomp on Step 1, the only free video series that helps you study more efficiently by focusing on the highest skill material. I'm Brian McDaniel, and I will be your guide on this journey through psychiatric medications. This is the ninth video in my playlist covering all of psychiatry for the USMLE Step 1 Medical Board Exam. I've already covered antidepressants in the previous video, so this video will just cover antipsychotics, mood stabilizers, and anxiolytics. We will start with the antipsychotics. I'm giving the overall class a high yield rating of 9 on a scale from 1 to 10, based on a number of factors, including how frequently these types of questions have appeared on retired Step 1 questions. When you break down the topic further, you can see by far the most important material is the side effects related with these medications. So make sure you focus your studying on the adverse reactions. We will start with a quick review of some material from my previous video on psychosis. Symptoms of schizophrenia can be broken down into two categories, positive and negative symptoms. Positive symptoms include behaviors or sensations that are not normally present. Examples include hallucinations, delusions, and catatonia. These symptoms are thought to be related to an excess of dopamine. I remember this by remembering that dopamine has a P in it, so it's P for positive and P for dopamine. Negative symptoms are the absence of normal behavior. Examples include a lack of initiative, diminished speech, disheveled appearance, and flat affect. These symptoms are thought to be related to an excess of serotonin. As we will see, antipsychotics affect dopamine and serotonin to varying levels. The indications for this class of drugs include psychosis, mainly schizophrenia, mania, mainly bipolar disorder, aggression, and Tourette's disease. Here's the list of the highest yield antipsychotics. I've included the trade name for some of them just for your reference, but remember that the exam will only include generic names. The typical antipsychotics, aka first-generation antipsychotics or neuroleptics, include haloperidol, flufenazine, thioridazine, and chlorpromazine. Most of them end in azine. Atypical antipsychotics, aka second-generation antipsychotics, include risperidone, aripiprazole, quetiapine, olanzapine, and clozapine. Most of them end in apine. Typical antipsychotics primarily block dopamine receptors in a non-specific manner. Therefore, these drugs work best for positive symptoms and have little effect on negative symptoms. A non-specific mechanism of the drug also means there are lots of side effects. Some of these medications come in a slow-release injectable form, so they can be used in non-compliant and aggressive patients. There are a lot of high-yield side effects, so we'll break them down one by one. Neuroleptic malignant syndrome, or NMS, is a rare but potentially fatal adverse reaction of typical antipsychotics. It involves fever, altered mental status, rigidity, and autonomic instability, such as tachycardia, hypertension, and diaphoresis. You may also see elevated myoglobin in blood or urine, and elevated creatine kinase, CK. One of the ways I think about it is that it looks kind of sort of like serotonin syndrome that you can see with antidepressants. If you see this, you have to emergently stop the medication, provide supportive care, and considering adding dantrolene. Extrapyramidal symptoms, or EPS, are due to blockage of nigrostriatal dopamine. It can present with a number of different symptoms. Akesthesia is a general sensation of restlessness. Acute dystonia is involuntary continuous muscle contractions, often of the neck. Another common presentation of acute dystonia is oculogyrus crisis, when your eyes get locked, looking upward, and you have to lean over to see. Dyskinesia, aka pseudo-Parkinsonisms, presents like Parkinson's disease with symptoms like pill rolling tremor, cogwheel rigidity, and bradykinesia, or slow movement. Tardive dyskinesia, or TD, is uncontrollable facial tics, grimacing, and tongue movements. As scary as these symptoms may look, they are generally not medical emergencies. In most cases, you will continue to use the drugs, with perhaps a reduction in the dose or the addition of an anticholinergic medication like benztropine or diphenhydramine. Tardive dyskinesia is the exception and requires cessation of the medication as it can become permanent. Usually, you would switch a patient with TD to a second-gen antipsychotic. Hyperprolactinemia is a side effect due to blockage of tuberoinfundibular dopamine. It presents just like any other disease that increases prolactin. So you can have galacturia, gynecomastia, decreased libido, and menstrual irregularities. These are not tested as often, but typical antipsychotics can also cause QT interval prolongation and anticholinergic effects such as sedation, orthostatic hypotension, dry mouth, constipation, etc. Atypical antipsychotics, aka second generation antipsychotics, block dopamine and serotonin receptors, meaning they treat positive and negative symptoms. They also may have improved specificity, which limits side effects when compared to typical antipsychotics. They are largely used as first-line medications instead of first-generation antipsychotics. You can still get all the same side effects as you do with the typical antipsychotics, but at least in theory, they should be much less common. In particular, risperidone has a side effect profile closer to the typical antipsychotics, as it has EPSS and hyperprolactinemia more commonly than the other second gens. Clozapine and quetiapine are the least like the typicals, as they essentially never have EPS or hyperprolactin. So if you're using a typical antipsychotic and you have to switch meds based on the side effects, quetiapine is probably the best option. Like some of the first gens, most of the second gen antipsychotics also commonly have sedation as a side effect. QT prolongation is another side effect seen in both classes, and it is especially common in ziprasidone. There are also side effects that are unique to atypical antipsychotics. One of them is metabolic syndrome, diabetes, weight gain, hyperlipidemia, etc. So patients on atypical antipsychotics should have their weight, blood pressure, blood glucose, and lipids monitored regularly. Olanzapine and clozapine are the worst for causing metabolic syndrome, so they should be avoided in patients who have diabetes or obesity. Ziprasidone and aripiprazole cause metabolic syndrome less than the other second gens. Clozapine is the prototype for the atypical antipsychotics, as it was the first one developed and has higher efficacy. However, it isn't used nearly as much as the others because it causes agranulocytosis and seizures. This drug is usually reserved as a last resort if the other options don't work. Patients on clozapine need to have a CBC very frequently to monitor for agranulocytosis. If a low white blood cell count is found, the medication needs to be discontinued to prevent life-threatening infections. Mood stabilizers are a group of medications that help to steady and/or prevent intense mood swings. These medications are used primarily for bipolar disorder and schizoaffective disorder. Many antipsychotic medications can have a mood stabilizing effect. They are the first-line treatment for mania when there are psychotic features and/or you need a fast onset of action. However, when we use the term mood stabilizer, we are generally talking about lithium and anticonvulsants rather than antipsychotics. Mood stabilizers require gradual titration and take about 1 week to kick in, so they are not as useful in the acute setting. However, for long-term treatment, they are often the treatment of choice for bipolar disease. A combination of an antipsychotic and a mood stabilizer is often used for bipolar disorder, as it usually works better than monotherapy for acute management and relapse prevention. Lithium is the first-line mood stabilizer according to most guidelines and textbooks, but in practice, many psychiatrists use other medications first due to better side effect profiles and other considerations that make it easier to prescribe. Lithium has a narrow therapeutic window, which means dosing can be difficult and requires close monitoring with lithium blood levels, which correlate with efficacy. The mechanism of lithium is not very well understood. Lithium toxicity, aka lithium overdose, may occur acutely from intentional or unintentional large doses of lithium, or chronically with a prescribed lithium dose that was not properly titrated. It can present with nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, tremors, altered mental status, incoordination, and seizures. If these symptoms arise, the lithium treatment should be discontinued immediately to prevent fatal consequences. Lithium is a teratogen that causes cardiac deformation in the fetus, so it should not be used in anyone who is or may become pregnant. Lithium commonly causes hypothyroidism. They love to write questions about that. Lithium is nephrotoxic and can cause nephrogenic diabetes insipidus with thirst, polyuria, that whole picture. So before you start the medication and regularly after initiation, you should get a pregnancy test, a thyroid level, and creatinine to monitor for the onset of side effects. That brings us to anticonvulsants. Some, but not all, epilepsy drugs can be used as mood stabilizers. This includes valproate or valproic acid, carbamazepine, and lamotrigine. These drugs are known to be hepatotoxic, so regular liver function tests, LFTs, should be performed. ACBC should also be checked as these drugs can have hematologic effects such as thrombocytopenia. Valproate or valproic acid is the most commonly used anticonvulsant for bipolar disorder. It is associated with spina bifida, so you have to give folate to patients if they are trying to get pregnant. It is also associated with pancreatitis. Carbamazepine and lamotrigine are alternatives. They are associated with rashes and severe hypersensitivity reactions like Stevens-Johnson syndrome. They can also lead to increased metabolism of hormones in oral contraceptives and unintentional pregnancies. This is obviously a bad thing considering the drug is also a teratogen. Next up is anxiolytics. This is a group of medications that relieve or abort anxiety. SSRIs and SNRIs are considered first-line pharmacologic treatment for generalized anxiety and panic disorder. We discussed these types of medications in depth in our previous video on antidepressants, and most of them do have anxiolytic properties. The only real difference is that the higher doses are usually needed to treat anxiety than depression. Cognitive behavioral therapy has similar efficacy to SSRIs, SNRIs, and is also considered a first-line treatment. The best treatment option may be a combination of an antidepressant with CBT. The downside to both of these first-line options is that they take about a month to start working. Buspirone is another good anxiolytic, while benzos and tricyclic antidepressants are considered second-line medications. Beta blockers like propranolol are not true anxiolytics, but they can help mask some of the symptoms of anxiety, such as palpitations. Buspirone or Buspar is another treatment option to consider for generalized anxiety, but it does not work for panic disorder. It is a non-benzo anxiolytic that functions by acting as a partial serotonin agonist. It does not have the risks of dependence, abuse, or withdrawal like benzos, and does not have nearly as much sedation. However, buspirone does take a couple weeks to kick in. Benzos usually end in zepam or azelam. They are broken into short-acting, intermediate-acting, and long-acting groups. However, short-acting benzos aren't used as much and are lower yield for the exam, so I haven't listed them. The highest yield intermediate-acting benzos are lorazepam, alprazolam, and temazepam. The most important long-acting benzodiazepines are clonazepam and diazepam. Benzodiazepines increase the effect of gamma-aminobutyric acid, aka GABA, an inhibitory neurotransmitter, by increasing GABA's affinity for the receptor and increasing the frequency of the chloride channel opening. Benzodiazepines are great at aborting acute anxiety and panic attacks quickly. They have a much faster onset of action than other anxiolytics. However, benzos don't work very well to prevent anxiety and panic attacks prophylactically. Perhaps the best use for benzos is in addition to an SSRI or SNRI. You can start both together, and then after about a month, when the antidepressant has started working, you can taper off the benzo. Benzos are largely considered safe for short-term use, but long-term use is very controversial due to the risk of abuse, dependence, sedation, and withdrawal. These medications are generally contraindicated in those with a history of substance abuse, and use in elderly populations should be limited due to the increased level of risk of adverse events. Scheduled long-acting doses are preferred because as-needed use of short-acting benzos has a higher risk for psychologic dependence. My last video in the psych section was on substance abuse and discussed things like benzo overdose and withdrawal, so go watch that one if you haven't already. I have also already covered the use of benzos for alcohol withdrawal, so I won't cover that here. Later, when I make the neuro videos, I will cover things like the use of benzos for seizures or status epilepticus. Benzos also have action as hypnotic medications and can be used for the short-term treatment of insomnia. However, their use should be limited to a few weeks' duration due to the risk of dependence. It is preferred that benzos be used intermittently and at the lowest effective dose. Higher doses of benzos are needed for the hypnotic effect when compared to the anxiolytic action. There are also non-benzo hypnotics that are, at least in theory, safer options for long-term use. This would include drugs like Lunesta and Ambien, but this topic is very low yield for the Step 1 exam, so I will skip it. That brings us to the end of this video. If you found it useful, please click on this orange subscribe button here if you're on a computer. This will make it easier to find my videos on the homepage of YouTube. This is the last video on my section covering all of psychiatry for the USMLE Step 1 Medical Board exam. If you missed any of those, please go back and watch them. You can also click on this blue box here to be taken to the Table of Contents page, which will list all the different sections I've covered. Thank you so much, and good luck studying.